Hi everybody, welcome to my YouTube channel Dr. Srinivas Medical Concepts and my FB page Dr. Srinivas Concepts. This is Dr. Srinivas, neurologist from Rajahmundry, Andhra Pradesh, India. I am also the medical author of the book Focused Neurology. My email is cklpm@gmail.com. Today we are going to talk about a very interesting topic, stroke and hemiplegia part 4 stroke syndromes. Stroke and hemiplegia part 4 stroke syndromes. So primarily there are 4 stroke syndromes: total anterior circulation syndrome, partial anterior circulation syndrome, lacunar syndrome and posterior circulation syndrome. Now let's talk about the total anterior circulation syndrome. So the common causes are middle cerebral artery occlusion. It could be because of embolism from the heart or major vessels. So it's a total anterior circulation syndrome, a major block. So the common symptoms are the combination of hemiparesis, because the middle cerebral artery is involved, the frontal lobe gets involved, so corticospinal tract gets affected, they would have hemiparesis. They would have higher cerebral function being affected, higher cerebral dysfunction, aphasia. So if an embolus lodges into the superior division of the left middle cerebral artery, it will result in Broca's aphasia. Whereas if an embolus lodges into the inferior division of the middle cerebral artery, it will result in Wernicke's aphasia. There would be hemisensory loss because middle cerebral artery also supplies the parietal lobe, wherein you have the sensory tracts, and finally the destination is the parietal lobe post central gyrus. There will be homonymous hemianopia because of the damage to the optic radiations. So if parietal lobe gets affected, there will be homonymous hemianopia, but there will be inferior quadrantonopia. So if parietal lobe gets affected, they would have inferior quadrantonopia. If temporal radiations get affected, they would have superior quadrantonopia. So homonymous hemianopia because of the damage of the radiations. Then we have the partial anterior circulation stroke. The common causes here are the occlusion of the branch of the middle cerebral artery or anterior cerebral artery. It could be either the embolism from the heart or major vessels. So these are partial anterior circulation syndromes where there is an occlusion of a branch of the middle cerebral artery or anterior cerebral artery, unlike the complete anterior circulation syndrome where the stem gets affected. So here the branch gets affected. So the symptoms would be isolated symptoms because they are partial anterior circulation syndrome. So isolated motor loss only, exacted higher cerebral function, only Broca's area or only Wernicke's area, it will result in aphasia, or only non-dominant parietal lobe, they will have hemineglect on the opposite side. Or there could be a mixture of higher cerebral dysfunction and motor loss, example aphasia with right hemiparesis, wherein the superior branch of the left MCA gets affected. So these are all partial anterior circulation syndromes. Then we have the lacunar syndromes. They are because of the thrombotic occlusion of the small perforating arteries, thromboses in situ. So they are occlusion of small perforating arteries, especially the lenticulostriate arteries of the middle cerebral artery. They're all end arteries. So hypertension is one of the important risk factors for lacunar strokes and lacunar syndromes. So if there is lipohyalinolysis, it will result in thrombosis. If there is Charcot Bouchard aneurysm, it will result in hemorrhage. So hypertension causes lipohyalinosis of the small perforating arteries, the end arteries, especially the lenticulostriate arteries of the middle cerebral arteries. Lacunar syndrome or lacunar infarcts are very small infarcts, very small size. So the common syndromes are pure motor hemiparesis of face, arm and leg. example, the internal capsule. The motor area and the internal capsule is supplied by the lenticulostriate arteries of the middle cerebral artery. So there could be pure motor hemiparesis. One important differentiating point between the Lackner syndrome and the anterior circulation syndrome, whether it is complete or partial, is that in Lackner syndromes, there will be pure motor hemiplegia or pure sensory stroke, but that cannot happen in an MCA stroke because middle cerebral artery supplies both motor area and sensory area. So in the middle cerebral artery gets occluded, both motor and sensory get affected together. So a combination of hemiplegia and hemisthesia would be present. There cannot be a pure motor hemiplegia or pure sensory stroke because both the areas are supplied by the same artery, the middle cerebral artery. Whereas in internal capsule, various arteries supply the internal capsule. The corticospinal tract may be predominantly supplied by the middle cerebral artery, the lenticulostriate arteries. The sensory tract may be supplied by the posterior cerebral artery. So the individual vessel can affect that specific tract and can result in pure forms like pure motor hemiparesis or pure sensory stroke. So if the middle cerebral artery, the lenticulostriate arteries get affected, the corticospinal fibers can get affected. It can result in pure motor hemiparesis of face, arm and leg, the lesion being the internal capsule or pons. Again, pure sensory stroke, it can be in the ventral thalamus where there was only sensory fibers. The thalamus supplied by the posterior cerebral artery, so it could result in pure sensory stroke. Ataxic hemiparesis, again the lesion could be in the internal capsule or pons. Internal capsule, because the fronto-ponto-cerebellar fibers go to the internal capsule, so the cerebellar fibers go to the internal capsule. It can go in through the pons into the cerebellum, fronto-ponto-cerebellar fibers. So when pons or internal capsule get affected, the afferent cerebellar fibers can get affected. It can result in ataxia. So along with it, the corticospinal tract also gets affected, so it will result in ataxic hemiparesis. Likewise, dysarthria clumsy hand syndrome. Dysarthria again because of the afferents of the cerebellar fibers being affected. Clumsy hand because when the corticospinal tract gets affected, the distal most parts of the limb, the distal muscles get affected, they can have clumsy hand syndrome. So these are the common Lackner syndromes: pure motor hemiparesis, pure sensory stroke, ataxic hemiparesis, or dysarthria clumsy hand syndrome. Right. Now we shall see the specific brainstem strokes of the posterior circulation, the common, most frequently seen in practice and commonly asked questions. The brainstem strokes, the posterior circulation. Weber syndrome, very, very important and commonly asked question and commonly seen in the neurology wards. Weber syndrome. The lesion, the site of the lesion is in the midbrain, the anterior cerebral peduncle. So they will have ipsilateral, all brainstem strokes will have ipsilateral cranial nerve palsy with contralateral hemiplegia. So here the lesion is in the midbrain, the anterior cerebral peduncle. The structures affected are the third nerve. So there will be ipsilateral third nerve palsy with contralateral hemiplegia and contralateral UMN seventh nerve palsy. So ipsilateral third nerve palsy with contralateral hemiplegia, it is Weber's syndrome. The site of lesion is anterior cerebral peduncle in the midbrain. Clot syndrome, again the lesion is in the midbrain cerebral peduncle, but this time involving red nucleus. So there will be ipsilateral third nerve palsy because the third nerve is involved, but since the red nucleus is involved and dentatorubrothalamocortical tract passes through the red nucleus from the cerebellum, there would be contralateral cerebellar signs. So ipsilateral third nerve palsy with contralateral cerebellar signs. The syndrome is clot syndrome and the site of the lesion is cerebral peduncle with the involvement of the red nucleus. Then we have a very interesting Parinaud syndrome where the site of the lesion is in the dorsal midbrain tectum. The clinical features, the classic features are upgaze palsy and convergence retraction nystagmus. So very interesting, exciting. Why should they have upgaze palsy and why should they have convergence retraction nystagmus? The midbrain is center for the vertical eye movements and the pons is the center for all horizontal eye movements. So midbrain is the center for vertical eye movements. Again, there are two types of vertical eye movements: upgaze and downgaze. upgaze fibers cross over in the midbrain and then descend. That is the rostral part of the midbrain and then descend. Whereas downgaze fibers descend straight away. So upgaze fibers cross and then descend. So if there's a lesion in the dorsal midbrain like pineal gland or hydrocephalus, it would go and impinge on the top of the midbrain. So selective upgaze palsies are more common because upgaze fibers cross and then descend, downgaze fibers descend straight away. So it goes and impinges on the upgaze fibers. So person cannot look upwards, they'll be looking only downwards. For example, Parinaud syndrome, dorsal midbrain syndrome, pineal gland tumor where it goes and impinges the crossing upgaze fibers, so they cannot look upwards, they'll be looking downwards. Again, in thalamic hemorrhage, thalam is very close to the midbrain, so it can go and impinge the crossing upgaze fibers. So in thalamic hemorrhage, persons do not look upwards, the eyes will be looking downwards. They'll have small pupils because the hypothalamus sympathetic fibers also get affected. Pupil cannot be dilated, it will be small. Again, hydrocephalus, it goes and impinges on the top of the midbrain. Upgaze fibers crossing, upgaze fibers get affected, they cannot look upwards, they'll be looking downwards. So in Parinaud syndrome, very classic is upgaze palsy, and they'll have convergence, retraction, nystagmus. Because the top of the midbrain gets affected, so what happens, the stimulus is disinhibited, the supranuclear eye movements for vertical gaze becomes disinhibited. Since it is the supranuclear fibers, both the superior rectus and inferior rectus are simultaneously stimulated. So when superior rectus and inferior rectus are simultaneously stimulated, both contract together. So superior rectus and inferior rectus contracting together, there will be retraction. Again, the divergence, because divergence is because of lateral rectus, sixth nerve, but pons is intact, so there is no divergence. It is only convergence because of the medial rectus involvement supplied by the third nerve and superior rectus and inferior rectus causing retraction. So upgaze palsy, convergence, retraction, nystagmus, very characteristic of Parinaud syndrome. The site of the lesion is the dorsal midbrain tectum where the upgaze fibers cross. Müller-Guber syndrome, commonly asked in MBBS final year, what is Müller-Guber syndrome? Müller-Guber syndrome, the site of the lesion is in the pontomedullary junction. Here the 6th nerve and the 7th nerves are present. So they'll have ipsilateral 6th nerve palsy, ipsilateral element type of 7th nerve palsy and contralateral hemiplegia. So 6th nerve palsy and 7th nerve palsy on one side and contralateral hemiplegia on the opposite side. It is Müller-Guber syndrome, the site of the lesion being pontomedullary junction. Then we have the most famous brainstem stroke, brainstem syndrome, the Wallenberg syndrome. The site of the lesion is lateral medulla. So we have the medulla, the lateral medulla and the medial medulla. Here the site of the lesion is lateral medulla. So all the structures which are placed sideways, that is in the lateral part of the medulla, get involved. Easy to remember are the structures which are placed sideways start with the letter S. So spinothalamic tract is involved, therefore they have contralateral spinothalamic sensory loss, pain and temperature sensory loss. So spinothalamic tract starts with the letter S, placed sideways. Sympathetic tract starts with the letter S, placed sideways. So if sympathetic tract gets affected, they would develop Horner's syndrome. Spinocerebellar tract starts with the letter S, placed sideways. If it gets affected, person will have vertigo, ataxia. And the sensory part of the cranial nerves, the fifth cranial nerve, the trigeminal nerve, spinal tract of the trigeminal nerve, if that gets affected, pain and temperature loss is on the same side. So all the four structures which start with the letter S are placed sideways. Spinothalamic tract, spinocerebellar tract, sympathetic tract and spinal tract of the trigeminal nerve. So all these four gets affected. So there is ipsilateral fifth nerve palsy along with the other cranial nerves, 9, 10, 11 cranial nerves. There is ipsilateral Horner's syndrome because the sympathetic tract gets affected. There will be ipsilateral Horner's syndrome. Ipsilateral cerebellar signs because the spinocerebellar tract gets affected. They will have contralateral spinothalamic sensory loss because the spinothalamic tract gets affected. They will have vestibular disturbances because the 8th nerve gets affected. And again, very important, the 12 cranial nerves, 4 are there in medulla oblongata and 9, 10, 11, 12. 4 are there in the pons, 5, 6, 7, 8. and 4 are there in midbrain and above, that is 3-4 in midbrain and 1-2 above the midbrain. How do we know that what cranial nerves are placed medially, what cranial nerves are placed laterally? Cranial nerves which divide 12 into equal parts are placed in the medial part, and cranial nerves which cannot divide 12 into equal parts are placed laterally. So 3-4 in midbrain, 6 in the pons, and 12 in the medulla oblongata are placed medially, because 3, 4, 6 and 12 can divide 12 into equal parts, whereas other cranial nerves cannot divide 12 into equal parts, so they are placed laterally. So in lateral medulla, the other cranial nerves are present. So except 12, the other cranial nerve 9, 10, 8, 9, 10, 11 are present on the sideways, so they get affected. 9, 10, 11 cranial nerve patch, and the fifth nerve has got a long course, the spinal tract of the trigeminal nerve, that also gets affected. So, and very important in Wallenberg syndrome is that the structures which start with the letter S are placed sideways, and the structures which start with the letter M are placed medially, M for M. So motor tract, that is the corticospinal tract, is medially placed. Medial longitudinal fascicles, MLF, which starts with the letter M, is placed medially. It connects 3rd nerve, 4th nerve, 6th nerve with 8th nerve. Motor part of the cranial nerves, they are also placed medially. And the medial longitudinal fascicles, MLF, is also placed medially. And medial lemniscus, the posterior column, is also placed medially. So medial lemniscus, the posterior column, is placed medially. The medial longitudinal fascicles is placed medially. The motor tract of the cranial nerves, they are also placed medially. And finally, the motor tract, corticospinal tract, is also placed medially. So in lateral medulla, the corticospinal tract is not affected because it is placed medially. Likewise, medial lemniscus is also not affected because it is placed medially. 12th nerve is also not affected because it is placed medially. So 12th nerve, posterior column and pyramidal tract, they do not get affected in Wallenberg syndrome. Very important, because they are placed medially. So lateral medulla or Wallenberg syndrome, they do not present with hemiplegia. I repeat, Wallenberg syndrome, they do not present with hemiplegia because it cannot affect corticospinal tract, because corticospinal tract is medially placed, whereas Wallenberg syndrome, the site of the lesion is in the lateral medulla. Yeah, cruciate hemiplegia, very interesting. We generally see hemiplegia is one-sided, either right upper limb, right lower limb, what we call as right hemiplegia, or left upper limb, left lower limb, we call it as left hemiplegia. But cruciate hemiplegia is very interesting. One side upper limb and opposite side lower limb weakness. Example, right upper limb and left lower limb weakness, that is cruciate hemiplegia. How do you explain this very strange phenomenon? The explanation is that the corticospinal tract come on one side and cross at the level of the medulla oblongata and go to the opposite side. But not all the fibers cross equally together and go to the opposite side. Upper fibers cross above and the lower fibers cross below. Upper fibers cross above and the lower fibers cross below. So various combinations can get affected if there's a small lesion in the medulla oblongata. Only if there's a lesion where the upper limb fibers cross, you can get bibrachial weakness. If we get a lesion where the lower limb fibers cross selectively, we get crural paraparesis. But if we get if there's a lesion wherein uncrossed upper limb fibers and crossed lower limb fibers are affected, then one side upper limb and then the other side lower limb can get affected, which is known as cruciate hemiplegia. So these three combinations are possible in the medulla oblongata: bibrachial weakness, crural weakness, or one side upper limb, the other side lower limb, what we call as cruciate hemiplegia. So upper limb fibers of the corticospinal tract cross above and the lower limb fibers of corticospinal tract cross below in the medulla oblongata. Therefore, a selective lesion could occur in the site of the crossed upper limb fibers and uncrossed lower limb fibers, resulting in cruciate hemiplegia. So here you can see the diagram, the upper limb fibers cross above, the lower limb fibers cross below. So if there's a lesion here, as it is pointed out here, if there's a lesion here, what happens here? The left upper limb is affected, but then the right lower limb is affected. So the crossed left upper limb and the uncrossed lower limb fibers get affected here. So uncrossed right lower limb and crossed left upper limb, resulting in left upper limb weakness and right lower limb weakness, what we call it as cruciate hemiplegia. So very interesting. If there's a lesion selectively here, they'll get only weakness of the upper limbs. If there's a lesion selectively here, they'll get weakness of only the lower limbs. But if there's a lesion here, or if there's a lesion here, the possibility is that one side upper limb and the other side lower limb gets affected, what we call as cruciate hemiplegia. Yeah, this is the book I've written, Focused Neurology. I'm the medical author of the book Focused Neurology. Most of the neurology points I put it in a question answer form. It can be bought online. So this is about stroke syndromes. I really enjoyed giving this lecture, and I hope you have also enjoyed listening to my lecture. If you have any suggestions or comments, kindly post on to my YouTube channel. But please like and subscribe my YouTube channel, Dr. Srinivas Medical Concepts, and my FB page, Dr. Srinivas Concepts. Thank you. Bye.